At the onset, I would like to thank Dr. Anil Handu and the Mindray India team for inviting me here to make my presentation. So as this is probably the last presentation of the day, I'll try and make it within time. One more to go, sir? Yeah. So the title is Predictive Markers in the Dengue of Journey So Far. So this here is the aerial view of the city of Vancouver where the ISLH is this year. And the journey of the predictive markers of dengue actually began in this city itself, in Hinduja Hospital sometime in 2013-14 maybe. And ma'am is sitting right here, Dr. Shanaz, where the first paper came that, you know, immature platelet fractions can be a predictive marker for thrombocytopenic dengue patients. And, you know, they were the innovators and we were kind of the early adopters. So I saw this paper and I said, no, this is the panacea solution to my problem in Delhi. And we started to do IPF sometime in 2014. And everything was going okay till I hit a bottleneck that, you know, as sir said, that 10% figure of IPF recovery in 48 hours was not happening. In fact, a lot of my patients were having IPF as high as 30% and beyond. And there is no way I could tell the clinician that, look, at 10% you are in safe waters. So this led to the genesis of our first study that we did in December 2015, we presented at AIIMS. This was titled Peak Immature Platelet Fraction as a Predictive Marker of Platelet Recovery in Dengue Patients. So what we did was a simple study with simple objectives. We tried to establish peak IPF values in thrombocytopenic dengue patients and then try to establish platelet recovery from those peak values. And if majority patients would show a platelet recovery within a defined period, then IPF could be used as a predictive marker for clinical decision making. So the materials we used were PanBio and BioRad kits for dengue IgM and NS1 ELISA. And optical platelets and IPF were done on Mindray BC6800 analyzer. We used a simple four-step methodology. We first selected NS1 and IgM positive patients of dengue. Then we ruled out the patients who did not have thrombocytopenia. Then we further filtered the patient groups to include only those patients which had both rising and falling trend. We wanted to establish peak IPF for each one of our patients. If the patients had only a rising or a falling trend, we excluded them from our study as well. And then optical platelets were monitored daily till significant rise, and time to platelet recovery was estimated from peak IPF values for each one of our patients. Of course, we established the biological reference interval, which was 0.6 to 6.6%. We also did a precision study for both optical platelet and IPF, which was showing good CV across different ranges. And we did smear validation of all optical platelets with special emphasis on giant platelets and platelet aggregates, which kind of, you know, impede the impedance-based counting. So the results were as follows. This is the graph. The peak IPF values range from 5.5 to 38.7% with a mean of 13.5 and standard deviation of 6.14. One thing was very clear, that we could not look at IPF with ballpark figures. We had to follow trend analysis, and trend analysis for each patient individually, there could be no general ballpark figure. Another interesting finding was that 86% of our patients who had values more than 20% were ethnically from Bengal, Bihar and Eastern UP. Typically the Harris platelet syndrome belt. 100% patients showed significant platelet recovery after attaining peak IPF and 86 within 72 hours. Thus, peak IPF offered strong correlation with time to recovery of platelet counts. So we had three takeaway conclusions from it. Peak IPF was a promising predictor of time to recovery of platelets. Single IPF value more than 10% was not a reliable marker for platelet recovery within 24 to 48 hours. And peak IPF value in dengue patients of different ethnic groups could be a subject for further study, which it was. Dr. Sen Gupta is sitting here. She did a study on biological reference interval in Calcutta, and I think your range was something like 14-15%. Yeah. So our North Indian population biological reference interval was 5-6%, whereas in Calcutta, the same biological reference interval was 14-15%. So ethnicity plays a big role in IPF. So we were first time lucky. They say there's beginner's luck. We got the first prize for this patient-based research in AIIMS, which kind of propelled us to do our second study in December 16, which was titled A Comparative Study of Immature Platelet Fraction Values on Mindray BC6800 and Sysmex XN1000 hematology analyzers. So what was happening was patients were coming to me sometimes with reports from my lab, sometimes from some other lab, and they used to ask me to correlate the IPF values between different machines. Now different manufacturers, different dyes, even different algorithms. And to top it all, IPF is not an estimated parameter, it's a calculated parameter. So there was no way I was going to, you know, stick out my neck without doing a correlation. So we did this study, it was a simple study. The objective of the study was to establish correlation between IPF between the two manufacturers, Mindray and Sysmex. So the materials were obvious, BC6800 Mindray for Mindray-based analysis, XN1000 for Sysmex, and ZEISS microscopy for slide reviews. So this study had to be multicentric because we don't have Sysmex XN system in our laboratory. So we tied up with Medanta and a lab in South Delhi near Chittaranjan Park. For those of you who don't know the geography of Delhi, Chittaranjan Park is like a mini Calcutta within Delhi, so you can get all those Harris platelet syndrome patients there. So this was a multicentric study, and we separated the patients which were coming randomly into two equal groups, IPF less than 6 and IPF more than 6%, so normal and abnormal half and half ratio. All selected samples were analyzed on XN1000, and the time interval between phlebotomy and final analysis was always less than 6 hours to take care of the pre-analytical variability. We finally did smear validation to eliminate cases of WBC and RBC fragments. And then we did what we call as the Deming regression analysis. And you can see that the R value was pretty robust, more than 0.9 across IPF, IPF less than 6, more than 6, optical platelet, as well as mean platelet volume. However, the IPF in patients with IPF more than 6 was slightly lower than general IPF and patients with IPF less than 6%, but this was expected, because IPF more than 6% is usually seen in thrombocytopenic patients, and they are likely to have slightly higher analyzer CV for platelets as well. So the conclusion was that the regression analysis between IPF of both analyzers showed good correlation, and we presented this paper in the API Global Healthcare Summit in Udaipur, and I didn't think much of this paper, but Mindray team was kind of keen, but luckily we got a third prize there also. So which brings me to my final paper, which we are going to present at ISLH this year in Vancouver. This is called a clinical evaluation of various predictive markers of platelet recovery in dengue patients. So I've been hearing all kinds of markers, you know, immature platelet fraction, HFC, platelet lymphocyte ratio, neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, even high fluorescence IPF. So a lot of competing markers are now doing the rounds that, you know, I'm a better predictor, I'm a better predictor of platelet recovery. So what we decided to do was that, you know, since many parameters are available for predicting platelet recovery, it was required to evaluate all of them and find the most efficacious one. So we evaluated different parameters and their trends to predict platelet recovery within a defined periods. So as usual, we first went with dengue positive patients with thrombocytopenia. Then we filtered to include only those exhibiting both rising and falling trends of platelets, as well as the predictive markers for this study. And the criteria for significant platelet recovery was an increase in platelet count by 10,000 or 10%, whichever is lower, over the preceding value. And the predictive markers were classified primarily into peaks and troughs. So there are some markers which peak, like IPF, like HFC, like MPV, and there are some markers which have troughs or nadir points, like your ratios of platelet lymphocyte ratio, neutrophil lymphocyte ratio, platelet HFC ratios. In addition, we also did some jugglery. We tried to look for some jumps and falls as well. So HFC jump was taken when there was an increase of at least 3 times over the preceding values. And the falls were classified when there was a decrease in more than 50% from the preceding day value. So the parameters which were peaking were MPV, IPF, HIPF, and HFC. In HFC, in addition to the peak, we were also looking at the jump. Similarly, the parameters which were having a trough value were NLR, PLR, and PHR. These three ratios, in addition to trough, we were also looking at the falls. So this is the master table of the result. It looks pretty heavy, but I will just ease it up for you. First, look at the parameters which were recovering within 24 hours, especially neutrophil lymphocyte ratio and MPV. Now, if 70-80% of your patients are going to recover within 24 hours, and 24 hours is what is going to take to tell you that this was peak or trough, then the clinician would say, I'd rather follow the platelet, why bring your fancy parameter into play at all? So, to bring value to the table, we have to first remove this column of 24 hours. The patients who were giving delta values between 24 and 96 hours were the one which would contribute the maximum in terms of value addition for the parameter. So this is the bar chart of the 24 hours, and especially NLR and MPV were topping here, which means they were not very good parameters for doing platelet recovery. So coming to the basic seven parameters, we look at the delta values of each one of them. The topping the charts is the platelet HFC ratio, which is giving, you know, delta value of 52%. So nearly half the patients are going to give you an value addition in terms of following a PHR vis-a-vis only platelet. Coming close on the heels were both HFC and IPF, which were like 47 and 46% neck and neck together. But the best value addition came when we looked at the falls and jumps. So all the fall and jump parameters were performing better than the basic parameters. But topping the charts were the PHR fall, which was giving you a value addition of 71%. So if you follow PHR, in virtually 71% of thrombocytopenic dengue patients, it brings value addition to the table. So just to conclude, we could establish the clinical utility of all the above said markers for platelet recovery in dengue patients, and PHR fall was the most efficacious marker amongst the various parameters analyzed. And we are presenting this paper between 3 to 4 p.m. in Exhibit Hall B, May 10th. If any of you are going to Vancouver, please do visit us to encourage us. With these words, I thank you all, and if there are any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
I just have a question. When you say PHR fall, the fall always occurs in the first 2 days, or it comes later after a patient has been diagnosed?
So we are meaning PHR fall means when it is falling day to day, sir. So between 2 days, if the PHR value less than halves, that is my fall point.
Okay.
So that is my base point. From that point, I am looking at when the platelet is recovering. That day is my day zero, sir.
Okay. So how many days is your lag usually between PHR fall and the platelet recovery?
Okay. So PHR fall, the delta value between 24 hours to 96 hours, virtually 72% patient showed recovery. But if you're looking at total
recovery
number,
in how many days?
Pardon, sir?
How many days after the fall did they show the recovery?
How many days? Within 72 hours
within
of the fall.
Within 72 hours, okay.
So you were following your patients up to the, when it reached a peak, the,
Peaks or the troughs are the day zero. We are following from that day onward. We are following every day, but so we are looking at recovery from that day onward.
Basically you saw the platelet peak or the IPF peak and followed up.
Not the platelet peak, ma'am, the IPF peak. Or the MPV peak or the HFC peak.
Okay, so you followed them till the peak and you saw the individual peak.
So the day the IPF is peaking is my day zero. And from that day onwards, when
how
is
long?
My platelet recovery?
Yeah, so how long it takes? Basically rising trend and falling trend kind of a
yes,
situation
ma'am.
Only.
Yes.
But we've done a much larger study now, as I was telling you. And have you noticed that sometimes there are double peaks?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
And
so I have about five patients where there was a double peak of both IPF as well as HFC.
So any idea what the significance
sometimes
of this might
there
be?
Sometimes there is a double dip of platelets as well, ma'am.
Yeah.
It falls and then it recovers and you tell it's all going good, the next day it falls again.
Exactly. That's
so the clinician has a way of getting back at you.
The other question I asked is, have you thrown in the consideration that in between patient might have received a platelet transfusion which will throw all these parameters haywire?
Pardon sir, I didn't get the question.
So if there
PHR,
is a platelet transfusion.
If patient has received platelet transfusion, which you might have an information, you might not have an information.
So we are an OPD based lab, sir. Patients of transfusion would be going to Dr. Handu, would not be in my lab, sir.
No, but would you have that information? Because your double peak fall could be explained by
those double peaks are for non-transfused patients.
Non-transfused patients.
So, but it's also well known, you know, I'm not talking about double peaks here. Have we tried to look at reinfections within dengue, because that's also well known?
So there are patients with reinfection, there are patients with co-infection. We have seen patients with dengue and typhoid, we've seen patients with dengue and chikungunya, and we've seen patients with dengue and malaria as well, sir.
But my query was with respect to these double peaks, because ma'am is also telling
me. No, those were pure cases, sir. They were not co-infection cases, sir. But there are cases, sir.
Regarding this double peak, I have an alternative view, and basically what we are dealing with here is the immune process which is trying to push back the platelet destruction. So that might not work the first time. So there might be multiple attempts by the immune system to reignite the platelet or rather decrease the platelet destruction. So that's the reason why, because immune system is like a mutually antagonistic process is going on. So at times one arm of the platelet destruction arm might supersede again, that might lead to further dip, then further increase. So there might be multiple. We have also seen multiple dips, multiple peaks in other our VCS parameters as well. So that's a fairly common phenomena.
We wouldn't know the history is something that the clinician doesn't give. He would give his jewelry, but would not give his history.
Because these dengue patients tend to take so many things, sometimes simply homemade stuff. So you never know, like, if something like that is playing a role in a second dip. Or
pardon, I didn't get the question.
He's not getting.
Could be, sir, but I have a slightly different take. Most of these double peaks or double dips are actually having not too much of a delta value. Sometimes I feel that because it is a calculated parameter, sometimes the CV may be slightly higher. It could be just one of those things. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
But there are not too many patients like that. It's far and few in between.
So, thank you very much, Dr. Suri. It was an excellent presentation and very rich discussion also.